pictures that I have. That's my basic studio setup. The bass drums vary from sizes from 18 to 24s. And I most recently started in using larger, longer bass drums. Like if it's a 20-inch drum, it's also 20 inches long. If it's 22 inches, it's 20 inches long. It's 20 inches long only because that's as long as Pearl right now can make them all in one piece. And they're 9-ply maple. And the reason for that is I did some work with Nigel Olsen. He had bass drums that were 28 inches long. And the concept of that is, shortly, is to, can I move around with this thing? Hello? Okay. The bass drum, being 20 inches long, will be 6 inches longer than this one here. So the front head, I've got like a 12-inch on a 24-inch bass drum. I got a 12-inch hole cut out of the center. All right, what I do with it is, with the 20 inches depth, a lot of people would like to mic this bass drum, let's say. They would like to mic it out here somewhere to get a real round sound. A lot of country people would like to put the mic right up against the head and get that all the attack and no bottom end of it. So, like in Los Angeles, they try to get the attack with a lot of roundness. In Nashville, they try to get all the attack and forget the roundness. All right, so what we do is I take that 6-inch extra, and I've got the head on there, and I also have what looks like a shower cap. And it's all it is a piano quilt cut to fit around the bass drum with a little hole in the middle with Velcro on it. And you stick the mic in there and put the Velcro around it. And so what you end up with is a tunnel for this microphone, and your mic isn't right against the head. You got the attack and you got the tone. All right. So Pearl was nice enough to put that together for me. It ended up, after I did the initial record with Reed, I used some bongos on them on the session as concert toms. I didn't know what concert toms were at the time, so I used bongos, and then I had the toms coming down. Basically, what you see in the picture is what I use now. It's an 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. But in the studio, very seldom I use the 16. I just end up with the floor tom being the 14, 10 by 14. And that's the sound I used on England Dan stuff, Olivia, Dr. Hook, and different acts like that. It's fiberglass. The set that everybody requests is fiberglass. I have different preferences. That set is phenolic, and it's a real nice R&B sound. It's a very dark sound, but it still has a lot of projection. I put that set together, and they're basically single-headed drums. I like my toms single-headed, because when you get in here and you start in a studio, speaking of, you get in there, and in Nashville, you got a 3-hour session. It may take you 3 hours to get those double heads in tune, getting rid of all these overtones from this top head to the bottom head, if you move them around a lot, which mine do move quite a bit. So I end up with a lot of single-headed toms that record pretty well. And I like to mic them from underneath, doing approximately the same thing I do with the bass drum. Get it just about in the center, right about here, and not up in the shell, but just even with the shell. When it goes inside, it starts reverberating. And so then you create a problem, a lot of inner overtones that just really don't work out. So, from the experiences I've had with the toms, the way I tune them, I tune very low in the studio. They're emperor heads, clear emperor heads. It can tend to get very boomy. So that's how I like to mic them. My cymbal setup is just about the same that's in the picture. It's kind of like this. I'll have my ride would be a 20-inch, about a medium thin. It's an old Belson cymbal. And you can crash it pretty good, or you can ride on it real nice. And my crash cymbals vary from 18 down to 14-inch cymbals, but they're all pretty thin, the studio-wise. The swish is 18 thin with about 26 rivets in it. And that gets the reason for so many rivets is that the rivets on the outside of the cymbal weight it down, so when you hit it, it doesn't hang on very long. This one's a little bit heavier than my studio one, but with it being real light, the rivets outweigh it, so it'll just kind of make it deader. My hi-hats in the studio are 13 inches, and they're quick beats. Very heavy, both of them. And this setup here, you see 13s and 14s. One's quick beats and one's not. Basically, the closed hi-hat, the one that stays closed all the time, is for when I'm doing double bass drum work and I don't want to reach over there and try to close the hi-hat and get it down tight and then get back and open it up and play it. It just never worked out for me. So you can put it just about anywhere you want to put it. Keltner uses his over here. He has two 15s, Pisces, he uses here. I used to use them up here and just wherever it feels most natural for you. And my snare drums, my snare drums, I use approximately 7 snare drums in the studio. And they're all different, you know. I mean, you got a producer that likes one that goes like a shotgun, you know, pow! Then you got one that wants it to sound like you're in some cavern someplace, and so it varies from my deepest is a 10 by 14 with all emperor heads on it. And then I have an oversized drum like this that's maple, extender heads. It's got calfskin head on it. And its top head would be 15 inches, the bottom would be 14. Then the next drum would be 6 and a half by 14 metal. Then I have a 6 and a half by 14 fiberglass. Those, even though they tune the same, they both record different. One records one way in one studio, and one records another way in another studio. So then the 5-inch fiberglass I have I call it my Ringo drum, because it's got a calfskin on it, and it sounds like Ringo drum. You know, it just doesn't, we did some work together, and it his drums all, the same set he used on all of the records, and Wanna Hold Your Hand, all those things, all original calfskin heads that was originally on them, and 22-inch bass drum, 13-inch shell tom, 16-inch floor tom. And you appreciate this. He had, you know, George Martin, who is a tremendous producer and a tremendous man to work with, he would tell Ringo back then, he said, well, you know, the temperature would change in the studio and the drums would drop down. He'd say, Ringo, tune it. So whatever was closest is what Ringo would tune. You know, if this lug is closest, so the drums, they're real high back here and then they're real low back here, you know. He's bent the rims right out of shape. So, but the snare drums just sounded great. And I'm playing his snare drum, and I'd play his drums, he'd play my drums. We'd change off. But it was just tremendous, and I wanted to get that snare drum sound. So I went and got me a calfskin head, and I mean, they're miserable to work with. They're just, I mean, I'd forgotten really how bad they were. The original Motown set is what they had on them, and then a lot of you aren't this old, but they the heads changed, became plastic, and when we took the caskins off because they were breaking, we put plastic on. And God, you don't have to tune up, man. You come in and it's the same thing day after day. It never changes, you know. So that's what we thought, but it changed, but nobody knew the difference. So it was, but the caskin was really is really a pain in the neck. But they're so old now that they get in a position, no matter how cold he gets in the studio or whatever, those heads just don't move. So much oil on them and they're all beat up. But anyway, that 5-inch drum is, it's got a caskin on it, and I really like that one. And then the one, a 4-inch that I use on Roseanne Cash's stuff and Rodney Crowell, it's a 4-inch fiberglass. It's a real pow is. What's the record? 7-Year Ache was the latest thing that thing has been on. And that was just in a, you know, big room, just powing away, just beating it to death. But that one, and I have a couple other, like metal drums, that telescopic drums and stuff that I've picked up that you take in because it's a certain sound that somebody wants on a song, and you bring it in, whether it's a jingle or movie track or whatever you're doing. All right, basically about my drums, the studio set you see there, the live set that I use is primarily the same set, only I use, on stage I'll use 24s. Sometimes the heads are open in front, sometimes they want, it's too much power, so we put heads on and cut little holes in the front head and stick a mic in it. But Tom's setup will stay the same, the bass drums will be 2 24s. The snare now that I'm using is the extender snare with a new thing that Pearl's come out with for their parade line, which is cable. And now what he calls it, cable?
It's steel cable with flashing around.
It's a blue looking thing. And I mean, this sucker is loud. And most drums, your drum doesn't do this, which we were talking about today. It doesn't choke down. Most drums, when you hit it, like if you hit it like that, you get that much volume out of it. You hit it like that, you get that much volume out of it. No matter how hard you hit it, you ain't gonna get any more volume out of it than when you just did that. I don't care how big your sticks are. So that was the problem I was having with this particular band. We were going out doing some concerts with Roseanne, and we were playing big, huge step. We played here, we played a festival here. And I didn't have that snare at the time. My bass drums were overpowering my snare drum and the extra long bass drums. So I went to the man who works at Pearl, Al Duffy, who used to be with the Boston Pops and designed Henger snare drums. He designed the chain foot pedal and all this stuff. And I said, Al, you got to understand these bass drums now. I've corrected my bass drum problem, but I've created a snare drum problem. And so he says, all right, we'll correct that. So I didn't want a marching snare drum. So he said, he took this drum, something like this, and he put these cable snares on it. And when you hit it, as hard as you can hit it, that's how loud it's going to be. And it's like parade drummers do. So by working with it, it's not the same kind of sound. It's a much drier sound than normal snares would be. If any of you played in high school bands that used gut snares or wire snares, you see a difference where with these kind of snares, you can make it rattle and you can sound real good. You know, yeah, I sound great, you know. And you don't always sound that good because you're not playing the way you actually should be playing. All right, with these wires or gut snares, you can't fake it. There ain't no faking it. You play it, and if you play it, you hear it. If you don't play it, you don't hear it. On wires, Like normally come on snare drums, a lot of times you can play things and you thought, hey, I did that pretty good, but you didn't actually play it. The drum air went ditch, ditch, and you were just going ditch, and you thought you were doing a roll, but you were just dropping your stick down there and it ain't doing nothing. So the cables really bring it to life, and it's kind of unique. It's not for everybody, but it's a different type of sound. That particular drum and the bass drums are really the only difference in my live set. I do have some ungodly foot pedals, everybody says, but they don't break, you know, and I think the whole time I was with Presley, it was one of the amazements he had was because every night he looked back, nothing was breaking, and when Tut was playing, he was nothing against what he was playing or the equipment he was playing, things would break because you're playing real hard and there was a lot of demand for you to pound. And my pedals would be together. He said, ain't nothing broke yet? And I said, no, nothing broke yet. And he said, every now and then he'd look around, nothing. I think he was wanting a rest. I don't know what he was looking for, but I think he was looking for a little break so I could fix equipment or something. But basically, that's my setup. The reason I don't use, Dave and I went through this at the trade show, the reason I don't use dead ringers, I really like them. They're in the bass drums here. I used them on a set that they were prototyping stuff. I think they sent some to Dave, they sent some to our place in Nashville. The reason I can't use them is because all my drums stack inside each other. So it just chews them up. But they work. They do what they say they do, which is a rarity in the drum world, you know. Yes, I do. What I use is, and it took me a long time to figure out how I ever lived without it, was duct tape. And I don't, I mean, for years I never saw duct tape. I never knew it even existed. And now, what I do is, my toms, first of all, I pick out the heads that I like. You know, I clear emperors and I try to, you know, I look at them and I get them. A lot of places you couldn't get into some of the stuff that I get into, but I pick out the heads that reasonably sound the same, equally as deep, equally as thin a sound. Whatever I start picking out, I go with that sound. And then I start taking duct tape. On an 8-inch tom, I tear it in half, like the regular, what is it, 2 inches, something like that, it comes out. I tear that in half, and I take about 3 spots on the head. And this is after I've torqued it up pretty good to break the glue away, all right? I torque it up, and then I put the tape around, like up here in this corner, here, and down in here. And then I start bringing the drum down into a reasonable range of its own. And each, I go in 2-inch sizes like that because it's easier for me to tune. When I go from like a 12 and a 13, I can't get either one far enough from each other to make a good enough sound. One is tuned out of its range. So within the 2 inches, like dropping 2 inches every so often, I get the drum within its own range. So the 8-inch, I find its range and find out where it sounds good. Sometimes I have to take one piece of tape off, sometimes two off, sometimes add. Also, I found by taking the duct tape and putting on top of each other, it's adding the weight to keep the head from moving too much when it's that low. And on the 10, it's about the same thickness. I tear it in half and I put it on the 10 the same way. But on the 12 and the 14 and the 16, I keep it wide, the 2 inches, and maybe about 4 inches long, and just place it in the same areas. And certain drums, like I have about 12 sets that I use. There's different sets. I have a set in New York, and I have a set in London, set in Los Angeles. And depending on what kind of stuff I do in these places, and there's 6 sets at home that I have, maybe I have to have a big band sound, you know, and the heads are ambassador coated, and They have that traditional kind of sound. A smooth white emperor on my phenolic drums create a lower sound. They create a more R&B sound. And the phenolic is what they, it's the base of what they make fiberglass out of. So it, but it doesn't quite have the thinness, the brightness that fiberglass has. So with these sets, I have the versatility of which a lot of people don't have. If I'm working an R&B date at 10 o'clock in the morning, and at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I'm working with Hank Snow, I don't want that kind of sound on a Hank Snow session. So the sets vary, and the muffling varies a little bit. I use on my double-headed drums. Oh, this is something that's important. I use what they call rim, the rim, and some Geiger product, and Kunkel and Jim Keltner and myself, Steve Gadd. The idea was that if you have nothing mounted to the shell will vibrate and give you the total range of the drum, the highs, the mid, and the lows. Well, it's true, it works on a double-headed drum. It doesn't necessarily work. I haven't been able to get it work on a single-headed drum. And Geiger says the response is because you're actually getting the tonal quality from the bottom head using this rim, which you don't have on a single-headed drum. But it makes a night and day difference. Now, Keltner is right now with Yamaha. He's coming over to Pearl, it looks like. And he's real interested in trying to get these rims on these drums, because he figures if he can get the mount off the side of the drum, which clamps down, and the idea is that takes away some part of the range, that maybe that will increase, I don't know how you need more volume, but it maybe increase the volume and the range of it. But the muffling would still be about the same with the drums that I use these on. And they're on the double-headed drums, and they work great. I mean, just rich. Real, like a 12-inch drum sounds like about a 16. You know? Lead tape. No, I don't know what it looks like. I may have seen it and not know it. No. Real lead? It sets up that high? Oh, it's just that wide. Oh, but it's a lot heavier. No, but every I know I've tried masking tape. You've tried, you know, they come in and put pads on your drums and many other things they put on your drum, and they stick it down with Scotch tape with all this stuff, and there's a big difference between tapes. So I mean, I've not heard it, so it would be something to look into. Add another layer. Well, when you get into a larger drum, when you get into a 16, 18-inch time, a lot of people have the conception that in a studio, that a larger drum will give you a larger sound, and that's not always the case. The case is having a good-sounding drum, and when you get a 16 or an 18-inch drum wide open, a lot of times the range that drum has can never get on tape. It never makes it because of the percussiveness that you're hitting it, you know, and the range that the drum is already in. So what we did was make a test. We were trying to do an album and come up with sounds, and we found that the smaller drums worked better for what we were doing. And even in that case, the 14-inch drum tuned down that low would vibrate. You'd hit it, and it would just, you could see the head doing that. So by putting tape out on the ends, it'll bang, 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 bang. It would weight it down. A lot of times I take a head and we tune it perfectly in tune, and to get the drop out of it, to get doom. You take and you get it perfectly in tune, and then you start untuning one or two lugs. And that would make it drop a little more. You can do it like with a double head, you can keep the top head, like Gad does it with the bottom heads. All right, he would tune everything up where he could play all his little cute stuff on, you know. And then they're like timbales, you know. Cobham does the same thing. But the bottom head, then you tune down, you actually do your tuning with the bottom head and detune a couple lugs, and that'll make it go doom. Doom. Just drop a little bit, right? Just boom. Boom. Okay, well, with single-headed toms, you do the same thing, only you don't have to mess around with no bottom head. You just take and you get your drum in tune, how you like it, and usually where there is no tape, you get the most drop. And it works kind of like this. It works, it's like throwing a pebble in a clear lake. You throw a pebble and it ripples out. Big old ripple comes out. Well, the sound does the same thing on the drum head. You hit the head and the sound goes around like this. When it goes over that ripple, however wide that ripple is, if it's one lug or two lugs, you can get doom, 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 doom. You can make it whatever you want to make it. And it's not real good for the head. You know, I mean, it can go through them. You can hit it in that spot. And Dave would love it. You know, it would just be great. Buy more heads that way. But I've not tried that tape, but I'd like to see some of it. Now, terminologies, as we started to get in before, what do you want?
Would I have to say for you, do you use the double thicker emperors on the extender, or do you use the bastards?
I use emperors, yeah. And there again, on the extended heads, depending on the sound you want, you don't have to cook them. You know, like, I don't know if you got into that with Al or not, but it does create, they are a little bit deader without cooking them. But what I did on a session that I was doing, I had a 12-inch, I believe it's 12-inch drum, 13-inch. So it'd be something, it'd be this size, I think. What I did was I was playing the part, boom, right? But the head around here I didn't cook, so it had little ripples in it. And if you go over, it's like those little plastic bags that you get, you pop the bag, you know, pop the little bubbles, you know. All right, so I had these little bubbles around there, so I went, boom. All right, so we put another little mic near here, and I played the boom on another drum, which was the low part, and we kept it because the two levels would come out wrong. You'd be pinging with the boom, and you wouldn't pick up the part. So by doing the low part on another drum, and I had this little neat little ripple. I mean, it would be the same thing if we took this drum and put another head on it. You'd have the ripples around there, and you're playing the part, and you're just going just a short distance, and the ripples would just kind of pop. But it's just like almost like going down a scratcher or something, you know. Say, and the engineer's going crazy trying to figure out what the hell this is. And what happened was I just didn't have the time to take a hairdryer or a heat gun, shrinker or whatever, and cook the head out. And that's basically what you have to do with these drums. Now, Remo, I was told the other day, Remo is going to be supplying heads already cooked. That's fine. If that's the sound you want for the drum, that's great. But you can get a regular head and put it on here, and it'll just be wrinkled on the outside, and it'll sound a little deader. If you don't want all that ring, that's what it'll do. And it works great. It's like having another instrument laying around there. But the only difference is if you're doing it and you're doing a part, it wouldn't be real loud if you were trying to do it on stage or something, you know. You'd have to have a mic put on it, something like that. Answer your question, huh?